December 31st, 2017. The Indianapolis Colts defeat the Houston Texans 22-13 in the final game of the 2017 regular season. It was a small bright spot in an otherwise disastrous season for the Colts, who lost franchise quarterback Andrew Luck for the year to a shoulder injury. The team finished the season 4-12 and out of the playoffs for the third straight year. It was time for a change at the top. Chuck Pagano, the six-year head coach of the team, was fired less than an hour after the Colts' win over the Texans. The Colts waited and watched as the 2017-2018 NFL playoffs played out before making their final decision. The Colts, led by general manager Chris Ballard and owner Jim Irsay, had two primary candidates that they were interested in hiring, who happened to be the offensive coordinators of that year's two Super Bowl teams: New England Patriots offensive coordinator Josh McDaniels and Philadelphia Eagles offensive coordinator Frank Reich. Reich had history in the building as he was once the Colts wide receivers coach before the whole coaching staff was fired in 2012. Ultimately, the job was given to Josh McDaniels on February 6, 2018, who had helped the Patriots win two Super Bowls in the last 4 years, despite the fact that Reich's Eagles defeated the Patriots that year in Super Bowl 52. Later that same day, McDaniels backed out of the agreement and decided to stay in New England in a shocking public reversal. 5 days later, on February 11th, Frank Reich was hired as the new head coach of the Indianapolis Colts. From the start, the Colts organization did not want Reich to get the job, but their doubts initially seemed to be misplaced. However, Reich's tenure with the team would gradually collapse over time, ultimately leading to one of the biggest public collapses of an NFL organization in recent memory. How did things get so bad? From triumph to disarray, this is the story of the Frank Reich era Indianapolis Colts. The Colts in the Frank Reich era were widely known for great drafting, as they managed to make smart deals many times in the draft. They allowed the New York Jets to trade up to draft quarterback Sam Darnold,
a move I certainly wouldn't regret.
The Colts used the picks they received from New York to draft guard Quentin Nelson and linebacker Shaquille Leonard, as well as drafting running back Nyheim Hines in the 4th round and linebacker Zaire Franklin in the 7th. Overall, the 2018 NFL draft would be a massive success for Indianapolis, as they walked away with many top-notch starters to put around their foundational pieces, like wide receiver T.Y. Hilton and a healthy Andrew Luck entering his 7th year in the league. There was plenty of optimism in Naptown, but that optimism soon seemed misplaced. The Colts started the year a terrible 1-5 with some very tough losses on their record. Jack Doyle fumbled deep in Cincinnati territory, which was then taken to the house to ice the game in Week 1 against the Bengals. Andrew Luck was sacked on 4th and goal before a failed Hail Mary thrown by Jacoby Brissett against the Eagles in Week 3, and losses to New England and the Jets didn't help matters either. However, it was a Week 4 overtime loss to the Houston Texans that caught people's attention and was the first real sign of Frank Reich's unusual play calling. After coming back from 18 points down to tie the game, Reich decided to go for it on 4th and 4 from the Colts' 43-yard line with less than a minute left. Luck's pass fell incomplete and Houston kicked the game-winning field goal as time expired in overtime. Reich said he wanted to go for it as he felt it wasn't cool to play for the tie,
or something stupid like that.
The Colts didn't have much margin for error left, but to the surprise of many, they managed to hit their stride. Indianapolis won 9 of their final 10 games to save an otherwise dead season, including a rematch against the red-hot Texans in Week 14, a playoff-bound Cowboys team in Week 15, and close wins against Jacksonville, Miami, and a deciding game against Tennessee in the final week of the season to help them get across the finish line. The Colts finished 10-6 and earned the 6th and final seed in the AFC playoffs. Andrew Luck won Comeback Player of the Year and Shaquille Leonard won Defensive Rookie of the Year. The Colts then dominated the Texans on the road in the wildcard round 21-7 before losing at Kansas City 31-13 the following week. While it was a disappointing end to the year, Colts fans had plenty to look forward to in the future. With a good young core and a good head coach, many even considered Indianapolis a Super Bowl contender. They found more success in the draft with corner Rocky Asin, wide receiver Paris Campbell, and linebackers Bobby Okereke and EJ Speed. There was plenty of optimism to go around, but just before the 2019 NFL season, one of the most shocking announcements in NFL history was made that would ultimately lead to the downward spiral of the Frank Reich era.
See Andrew Luck on the sidelines. There is a report that has been filed by Adam Schefter of ESPN that Andrew has informed the team of his desire to retire from the National Football League.
During a preseason game against the Chicago Bears, it was leaked that franchise quarterback Andrew Luck was planning to retire after 7 seasons, 4 Pro Bowls, 4 postseason berths, and an AFC Championship game appearance. Luck later held a press conference to confirm these reports.
for the last 4 years or so, I've been in this cycle of injury, pain, rehab, injury, pain, rehab. And it's been unceasing and relenting, unrelenting, both in season, both in and off season. And I felt stuck in it. And the only way I see out is to no longer play football. It's taken my joy of this game away.
The greatest quarterback prospect since John Elway, the number one pick of the 2012 NFL Draft, the man who Jim Irsay had selected over Peyton Manning. Peyton Manning, arguably the greatest quarterback in the history of the National Football League. The man who built Lucas Oil Stadium. The man who saved football in the city of Indianapolis. And now the man who replaced him was out of the NFL. Colts fans were shocked and heartbroken. Some fans booed Luck as he walked away from that preseason game. Many would regret it. The Colts' Super Bowl hopes all of a sudden went up in flames. However, the team marched forward with Jacoby Brissett as their starter for the year. Initially, it didn't seem like the team had missed a beat without Luck, as Frank Reich's steady-handed leadership led the Colts to a 5-2 start to the season, with impressive wins against playoff-bound Titans and Texans teams, and even an upset win against the eventual Super Bowl champion Kansas City Chiefs in Week 5. However, after that, the season fell apart, as the Colts would lose 7 of their final 9 games to end the year 7-9 and miss the postseason. Injuries to Jacoby Brissett and T.Y. Hilton were a huge part of the team's collapse, as Brissett seemed to never fully recover from the injury, with ugly performances late in the year after a solid start. Brian Hoyer was even forced to start a few games. Quarterback issues would end up being the biggest theme of the Frank Reich era, as without a consistent starter in 2019, Reich wasn't able to coach the team to wins. Overall, while things could have been much worse after Luck's departure, the year was still a major disappointment. Frank Reich thought he and general manager Chris Ballard had a great solution to fix their quarterback problems. Their solution in question? A band-aid over a gaping wound. And it kinda worked? Tonight, I'm gonna have myself a real good... 2020. What a remarkable year in the history of the world. A global pandemic, a divisive U.S. presidential campaign, and Philip Rivers being an Indianapolis Colt.
A little football. Play a little real football.
Flatten it! Dadgum it, flatten it!
I just want to convert, dadgum. Son of a gun.
Whoop! Whoop! That's what I'm talking about! Heck yeah!
Oh, honey. Oh!
Hey, you weren't even close to making that play. You got a hand on it. You weren't even close. Dadgum.
Frank Reich and the Colts entered the offseason feeling like they were just a quarterback away from greatness, from climbing the proverbial mountaintop, from joining the ranks of legendary teams of the past to bring another championship to the city of Indianapolis. Many were expecting the Colts to go out and draft a rookie quarterback in the 2020 NFL Draft. However, signs soon pointed otherwise, as the Colts traded their 2020 first-round pick, 13th overall, to the defending NFC champion San Francisco 49ers for defensive tackle DeForest Buckner to strengthen the Colts' defensive front. Just 5 days later, on March 21st, the Colts signed 16-year veteran quarterback Philip Rivers. Rivers, the 4th overall pick of the 2004 NFL Draft, played 16 seasons for the San Diego and later Los Angeles Chargers from 2004 to 2019, 14 of which he spent as the primary starter. Rivers was certainly reaching the end of his NFL career, reaching one AFC Championship game in 2007 and no Super Bowls in his time with the Chargers. At the end of a terrible 5-11 season in 2019, the Chargers made the tough decision to move on from Rivers and use the 6th overall pick of the 2020 NFL Draft on Oregon quarterback Justin Herbert to replace him. Rivers wasn't ready to retire yet, though, going into free agency. Reich was intrigued by the prospect of not having to train up a rookie into the starting job, as well as getting to work with Rivers again, as he had been Rivers' quarterback coach in San Diego from 2013 to 2015. So he and Chris Ballard agreed to sign the 38-year-old Rivers to a one-year, $25 million deal. The Colts then had yet another excellent draft despite the lack of a first-round pick, getting wide receiver Michael Pittman Jr. and running back Jonathan Taylor early in the second round, safety Julian Blackman in the third, and cornerback Isaiah Rodgers in the sixth. The Colts went into the year with renewed vigor, though they were in what seemed like a three-way battle for the AFC South with the Titans and Texans, and COVID-19 threw the season for a loop, canceling all preseason games. The Colts' worst nightmare seemed to come through in Week 1 with a dreadful 20-27 loss to the lowly Jacksonville Jaguars. Though Rivers completed 36 of 46 passes, he threw two terrible interceptions, a staple of the Rivers era Chargers. However, the team would quickly bounce back, getting comfortable wins against the Vikings, Jets, and Bears to get the season rolling. Perhaps the biggest theme of the 2020 Colts was their inability to finish off their opponents late in games, especially against good opponents. The Colts lost close games to playoff-bound Ravens, Browns, and Steelers teams, all of which they had a shot to win late, especially against the Steelers, who had lost three straight games and were reeling down 10 late in the fourth quarter, but Rivers couldn't close the deal. They were also steamrolled by the Tennessee Titans at home earlier in the year. That's not to suggest there weren't good moments too, though. Coach Reich had arguably his best called season in the NFL, as the Colts won many big games, like a 17-point win at Tennessee, two close wins against the Houston Texans team that did not live up to the hype they had, and most impressively, an overtime win against the 13-3 Green Bay Packers, who would secure the top seed in the NFC. Despite how well Frank Reich coached and Philip Rivers performed overall, the Colts had to get some help if they wanted to make the playoffs. You see, the NFL had changed the playoff format that year. Instead of a 6-team format with the top 2 seeds receiving a bye in each conference, only the number 1 seed would get a bye, and a 7th seed would face the number 2 seed in the wildcard round. Despite a 10-5 record going into their final week rematch against the Jacksonville Jaguars, the Colts were the number 8 seed in an incredible AFC that year. The Titans had tiebreak over the Colts for the division, the Dolphins sat at the 5th seed, and the Ravens and Browns had head-to-head victories over the Colts for a tiebreak. The Colts had to beat the Jaguars, who, after beating the Colts Week 1, had lost 14 straight to enter that game 1-14, then watch and see if one of the other four teams would lose. The Titans beat the Texans to clinch the AFC South, the Ravens beat the Bengals, and the Browns beat the Steelers' backups. Thankfully for Indy, the 13-3 Buffalo Bills decided to play their starters in a meaningless game to them against the Miami Dolphins and promptly crushed them, giving the Colts the 7th and final AFC playoff spot. In the old format, the Colts would have been just the third 11-win team in NFL history to miss the playoffs, but instead they would get their shot against that same Buffalo Bills team that had beaten Miami and allowed the Colts to make it to the playoffs in the first place. Rivers and the Colts fought valiantly, but several mistakes were made in the game. It was a close game throughout, but in the end, Buffalo proved to be the better team. Trailing 24-27 with just seconds left, Rivers fired one final Hail Mary, which fell well short of the end zone and ultimately incomplete, sending the Colts home. As Rivers and the gang walked out of Buffalo that day, Rivers must have known that that was his final pass in the NFL, as 11 days after the January 9, 2021 game in Buffalo on January 20th, Philip Rivers announced his retirement from the NFL. It was clear that it was time to move on. While Frank Reich deserved a lot of credit for getting a solid season out of Rivers in the twilight of his career, he was still an aging quarterback and clearly didn't have the zing in his throws that he once had. So while Rivers walked off into the sunset, Frank Reich was once again left scratching his head. Luck had run out once again. It was all about luck. Reich had a decision to make. Should the Colts look into a QB-heavy draft class in 2021, or go out and get a veteran like Rivers? Reich decided to go for a free agent once again, but decided to go much younger. Little did Reich know that his choice for the new Colts QB would ultimately lead to his downfall in Indianapolis. Frank Reich and the Indianapolis Colts now had the same problem that they had had the last two off-seasons. They had what felt like a team not just ready to be a perennial playoff team, but a team that could be considered a true Super Bowl contender. The core was all there, developing playmakers on offense, a stout defense, a competent special teams unit.
Green Bay would know a thing or two about how important a good special teams unit is.
Three games and it's blocked! Picked up and a touchdown!
Why are we still here? Just to suffer.
And a coach and front office that had gained the trust of Colts fans. Once again, however, they were a quarterback away. Philip Rivers had played well in 2020, but wasn't able to get the team over the hump. He had clearly regressed physically despite remaining one of the smartest players in the league mentally. Frank Reich decided to take a different approach to finding the Colts' next quarterback. He decided to go out and find a guy who was easily one of the most gifted quarterbacks in the league physically. A huge arm, good running ability, tall and muscular, making him hard to bring down. But the trade-off was ultimately too tough for even this team to overcome. He was one of the dumbest decision-makers in the league. Carson Wentz, the 6-year quarterback from the Philadelphia Eagles, was at a crossroads in his career. He started out as a superstar, leading the Eagles to an incredible start to their 2017 campaign. He was the frontrunner for NFL MVP until he tore his ACL in a game against the Los Angeles Rams late in the year. Backup quarterback Nick Foles then led the team on a miraculous run all the way to being Super Bowl champions. While this is great for Frank Reich, who got a huge resume boost as the offensive coordinator for the team, Wentz's confidence was ruined. He sloppily led the team for 3 more seasons before being replaced by Jalen Hurts partway through the 2020 season. His 2020 season was horrific. With so many poor throws and decisions, it's hard to believe anyone could ever want to take a chance on him again. Frank Reich decided that he was the guy who could salvage Carson Wentz's career, and he and general manager Chris Ballard struck a trade, sending a third-round pick and conditional second-round pick to Philadelphia in exchange for the 28-year-old signal caller. If Wentz played 75% of the snaps, or if he played 70% and the Colts made the playoffs, that second-round pick would become Indianapolis' 2022 first-round pick. Reich and Ballard were clearly willing to take a gamble on the mistake-prone Wentz. The 2021 draft was a bit low-key for the Ballard-era Colts, though he once again did find some good players with defensive end Quiddy Pay in the first, tight end Kylan Granson in the fourth, as well as a young backup quarterback named Sam Ellinger out of Texas in the sixth round. Foreshadowing. With all the dust settled, it was now time to see how the Colts would perform with Carson Wentz. Could they get a great start to the season to swing momentum towards them and go on a potential run? Nope. For the second time in 4 years under Frank Reich, the Colts struggled early in the year, but unlike the 2018 season, there was no Andrew Luck to bail them out. Instead, they had Wentz, who did okay, definitely better than his 2020 season in Philly, but he couldn't pull the Colts to victory as the offense and defense both struggled. The Colts once again struggled to finish off good teams, losing close games against legit competition. Close losses to the Titans, Ravens, and eventual Super Bowl champion Rams led the team to a disastrous 1-4 record to start the year. That loss against Baltimore, an overtime loss on Monday Night Football, was the low point early for the Colts, as they blew a 19-point fourth-quarter lead. However, it was after this loss that the Colts' offense experienced a revelation. The Colts finally found a formula that was working wonders for them, the ground-and-pound game. Reich was definitely more of a pass-heavy guy up to that point, but was willing to go with the run game, led by superstar second-year running back Jonathan Taylor. Taylor was a beast for the Colts, gaining over 100 rushing yards in 10 of the Colts' 17 games. Despite a 31-34 overtime loss to the Tennessee Titans, which all but ended the Colts' hopes of winning the AFC South, the team stayed red-hot, winning 8 of 10 games after the 1-4 start. The high points were 41-15 demolishing of the Buffalo Bills, a game where Jonathan Taylor went for 185 yards and 5 touchdowns, a 27-17 win over the red-hot New England Patriots in Week 15, and a 22-16 win against the Arizona Cardinals on Christmas to get the Colts to 9-6 and all but guarantee a wild-card playoff spot. Jonathan Taylor was getting potential MVP hype, the Colts' defense was elite, and Carson had good stats. However, it's important to note that Carson's stats are a bit misleading. His 27 touchdowns to 7 interceptions ratio is good, but watching the Colts play, Wentz was still making some absolutely boneheaded decisions with the throws. He seemed to luck into having several dropped interceptions as he tried too often to play hero late in games. Look at some of these plays that Wentz made. Now imagine watching these in real time as a fan of the team. Still though, despite these concerns, everything seemed good in Indy, as the hottest team in football needed just one more win in the last 2 weeks of the season to earn a wild card spot in the playoffs for the second straight year. And nothing can go wrong. Oh no, it all went wrong! Carson Wentz was diagnosed with COVID-19 less than a week before the Colts' Week 17 matchup against the Las Vegas Raiders in their home finale. Colts fans scrambled with ideas of potentially even getting Phillip Rivers out of retirement to ensure a playoff spot being floated. It just so happened that the league changed its COVID guidelines that week, shortening the timeout from 10 days to 5, allowing Wentz to come back just in time for the game. When the Colts played against the heavy underdog Raiders, Wentz looked terrible. Sure, he didn't throw any interceptions, but he missed tons of huge throws and clearly didn't look himself after a week of sickness. The Colts put up a good effort, but the scrappy Raiders handed the Colts an L to drop them to 9-7. A disappointing loss, but it was okay. The Colts still controlled their own destiny, as they were set to take on the 2-14 Jacksonville Jaguars in the final week, a team who fired their first-year head coach midway through the season after the worst head coaching tenure in league history, a team with a rookie quarterback who had no room to develop, an offensive core that was only offensive in the way that gets you blocked on social media, and a defense that was almost equally as bad, 28th in the league. All the Colts had to do was beat out the NFL equivalent to Kansas football, and they would punch their ticket to the playoffs. And with this one simple task in mind, the Colts flew down to Duval County and got blown out by the worst team in football. It was a complete failure in all three phases. Jonathan Taylor could get nothing going on the ground, the defense couldn't stop a nosebleed, the offensive line couldn't block the Jags' weak pass rush, giving up 6 sacks, and Carson Wentz looked awful, throwing a terrible interception as well as losing a fumble. The Colts lost 26-11, and it should have been even worse if not for a worthless touchdown in the last few minutes. Jim Irsay was furious. The Colts fan base was furious. And the two of them both wanted heads for the embarrassment. Carson Wentz was immediately blamed, with many pointing out that he had screwed up multiple opportunities to lead the team to victory throughout the season. And so with that and no other real evaluations into potential coaching or other issues, Carson Wentz was ran out of town, being traded to the Washington Redskins. I mean football team. I mean Commanders. For 2 third-round picks, not the same value as the third and now first-round pick the Colts gave up for Wentz, though they did luck out that Washington was interested in even giving up that much for him. Frank Reich and Chris Ballard were now feeling private pressure from Jim Irsay after embarrassing him so badly. Irsay was no longer willing to be patient with them, They needed a quarterback to lead the way, and they needed one now. Since the team had no first-round pick, it was off to the trade market once again. Even with everything else having gone so wrong, Frank Reich and Chris Bauer didn't realize that they hadn't even hit rock bottom yet. For Frank Reich, the 2022 NFL season seemed to be his final opportunity to bring the Indianapolis Colts to glory. It was clear to many in the public that Coach Reich had lost the trust of owner Jim Irsay over the Carson Wentz disaster. The loss of their 2022 first-round pick, plus an overall weak quarterback class, essentially eliminated the chances of Indianapolis picking up a quarterback in the draft. So Reich and Bard once again looked at the trade and free agency markets for their next guy. The Colts seemed to luck out big time in this regard initially. The division rival Houston Texans were trading away Me Too movement supporter slash franchise quarterback Deshaun Watson after Watson supported the movement a little too much. The Colts were never in on the Watson trade since the Texans didn't want to send him to a division rival, but the Atlanta Falcons were in on Watson. The Falcons looked to move on from 14-year franchise quarterback Matt Ryan. Matt Ryan, also known as
Matty Ice,
was one of the best quarterbacks of his generation. While not a physical marvel, he had pinpoint accuracy and a rocket arm. The 37-year-old Ryan was pretty similar to 38-year-old Phillip Rivers, two previously elite quarterbacks now aged, but still very smart players who could competently lead an offense. The Colts were even more competent with Matt Ryan than they were with Rivers, as Ryan never had a bad statistical season in his Falcons career. He also had way more accolades, winning NFL MVP in 2016 and leading the Falcons oh so close to Super Bowl glory.
Insert 28-3 reference here.
Matty Ice was a big-time player when it came to comebacks.
Sometimes for better and sometimes for worse.
Insert 28-3
reference here.
He was easily the apple of the eye of Frank Reich and Chris Bauer, and after a few days of consideration, Ryan ultimately asked to be traded to the Indianapolis Colts. This time, the Colts gave up just a third-round pick to Atlanta in exchange for the veteran. Colts fans, myself included, dreamed of the possibilities of plugging Matt Ryan into the Colts offense. A great offensive line, improving weapons, an elite run game with Jonathan Taylor and Nyheim Hines, and a quarterback with some moxie under center, supported by a good defense. Most picked the Colts to overcome the Titans, who had lost wide receiver AJ Brown and overall seemed like a much weaker team than in 2021, to win the AFC South. Some even had the Colts making a solid push in the playoffs. Things seemed to be going well, but problems soon arose. The Colts decided to part ways with franchise legend wide receiver T.Y. Hilton. While Hilton had struggled with injuries the last few years, he was still a great veteran presence in the locker room to train up the young receivers. The Colts also lost starting right guard Mark Golinski in free agency, as well as backup guard Chris Reed and left tackle Eric Fisher. The Colts definitely had some concerns going into the year, but surely a team with as much talent as this would find a way to push through and make a statement to the entire NFL. Nope. Frank Reich's time in his final season as Colts head coach could be summed up in one sentence: a tie with the Houston Texans. The Colts tied the beaten-up Texans in Week 1, and had it not been for a 17-point fourth-quarter comeback to send the game into overtime, the Colts would have lost the game. They were then shut out 24-0 by the Jacksonville Jaguars in Week 2, and many had already lost faith in the team. Colts fans had now fully turned on head coach Frank Reich. For example, he was the joke of the day on our student-run newscast the day after the Colts lost to the Jaguars. The team looked lost, outclassed in every sense of play. However, the team seemed like they may right the ship, as they secured a massive upset win over the Kansas City Chiefs in their home opener, tying Houston, getting blown out by Jacksonville, and beating Kansas City. If that doesn't scream Colts football to you, then I don't know what else will. However, while the Colts would celebrate for a second, things soon went bad again. The Colts lost to the Titans, beat the Broncos in the sloppiest game of football since Hitler was alive, beat Jacksonville in a rematch, but then lost to the Titans again in that rematch. This stretch of games can be examined as the ultimate case study on the Indianapolis Colts season. In most of these games, Matt Ryan looked absolutely atrocious, leading the league with 9 interceptions and 11 fumbles in 7 games. This was particularly evident against Denver, as Ryan threw 2 bad interceptions and fumbled twice, though the team won in the end. This Denver game is also a great example of the Colts' other major problem. The offensive line couldn't block to save their lives. The Colts' offensive line, the highest paid unit in football, had completely fallen apart, with shuffling of pieces all around the line and just generally poor play. This led to Matt Ryan being sacked more times in 7 games than Phillip Rivers was in all 16 regular season games in 2020. The lack of blocking also led to the disappearance of Jonathan Taylor, who struggled with injuries and even when healthy couldn't get any blocking to run the way he did the previous year. Matt Ryan's time in Indy looked like it had come to an end after an embarrassing performance against the Tennessee Titans, throwing 2 interceptions including an ugly pick 6, leading the Titans to their second straight sweeping of the Colts. Colts owner Jim Irsay took his 0% patience and somehow dipped it into the negatives, and after a meeting with Frank Reich and Chris Bauer, the team announced that they had benched Matt Ryan for second-year quarterback Sam Ehlinger. It was clear that Reich didn't want to make the move, but considering how none of his decisions about the offense had worked up to this point, he really didn't deserve a say. Ehlinger made his NFL debut against the Washington Commanders, who themselves had lost Carson Wentz to injury and had to start Taylor Heinicke at quarterback. Ehlinger performed alright for his first NFL game, but mistakes by other offensive teammates led the Colts to blowing a 9-point fourth quarter lead to lose 16-17 and fall to 3-4-1 on the year. That week, Frank Reich got a scapegoat when Jim Irsay fired offensive coordinator Marcus Brady, meaning Reich would get to call all offensive plays in the team's Week 9 matchup against the New England Patriots. And with all the weight of the organization on his shoulders, his job on the line, and the Colts' season on life support, Frank Reich led the Indianapolis Colts to an incredible 26-3 blowout loss to the 4-4 Patriots. Nothing worked offensively, Ehlinger was sacked 9 times by New England's stout defense, and the whole team generally looked awful. Less than 24 hours later, Jim Irsay announced that Frank Reich was fired as the head coach of the Indianapolis Colts. In 4.5 seasons as Colts head coach, Frank Reich posted a record of 40-33-1 with 2 playoff appearances, 0 division titles, and 1 wildcard win in his first year. It truly is amazing how that year, 2018, perfectly shows the Frank Reich conundrum encapsulated. Frank Reich and Chris Bauer built their era of the Indianapolis Colts with the idea of having Andrew Luck at quarterback to utilize the pieces around him. A great run game, a formidable offensive line, a good defense, all they needed was a guy who could consistently work towards improving his and the team's game. This was visible in 2018 as Luck carried the team out of their 1-5 hole to win a playoff game. The moment Andrew Luck retired, Frank Reich was doomed. You see, Frank Reich was always adamant about calling games his way, and his way was directly adapted to what Andrew Luck liked to do. Reich was a generally aggressive play caller. These plays worked like a charm when he had Andrew Luck under center, a guy who had a reckless but effective style of play, but when asked to adapt his play calling style to new quarterbacks, he struggled immensely. He gets a pass for the year with Jacoby Brissett, as he had very limited time to adapt given Andrew Luck's short-term notice before his retirement. Reich did a decent job with Phillip Rivers in his pocket passing style, keeping things pretty standard across the board offensively. 2021 with Carson Wentz was when Reich fell apart as a play caller. Reich felt like he finally had some newfound freedom. In his mind, it was almost like he had Andrew Luck under center again. The difference between Andrew Luck and Carson Wentz is obviously immense, however. Wentz never fully regained his confidence even with Reich, as he tried to adapt to Frank Reich's Andrew Luck system, leading to inconsistent performance by Wentz. Even though he would occasionally have a nice game, he never looked comfortable in his role. This problem was amplified with Matt Ryan under center. Reich now had to go back to the playstyle of Phillip Rivers, pretty boring and just pocket passing. It's almost as if Reich seemed bored with Matt Ryan, wanting to take risks and gamble, but with a more limited quarterback, he didn't call the correct plays to suit the needs of his QB. This also links back to Frank Reich's preference towards passing over running. While the Colts had a solid run game during Reich's time, thanks to a solid O-line and good running backs, it always felt secondary to Reich. He was, after all, a quarterback in the NFL, so it would make sense that he would prefer letting the quarterback make plays. This issue was especially glaring in 2021, as, rather than have Jonathan Taylor, the NFL's rushing leader, take control in many cases, he put full faith in Carson Wentz, and this often would lead to boneheaded plays. The same thing happened in a short 2022 stint, letting Matt Ryan take control of plays way too often. The idea of throwing the ball on first down and running on second down, quite frankly, no pun intended, makes zero sense, even with a bad offensive line. If you're going to take a shot early in a drive, you should not be calling a play with the hopes of picking up 2 to 3 yards on second down. This confusing play calling led to Reich thinking way too hard about decision making in his play calling, almost as if he was trying to trick the defense at points. It's 4th and goal, already a risky play to make. Rather than run a traditional play, handing it off to Jonathan Taylor or even Naeem Hines, a pass by Matt Ryan, Reich sends Matty Ice into a wide receiver stance. He then puts Naeem Hines in shotgun with Jonathan Taylor next to him. Hines takes the snap, fakes a handoff to Taylor, and runs up the middle for a loss and turnover on downs. Even a team like Houston was able to read that one immediately. If they were going to do a trick play, it may have made more sense to actually hand it off to Taylor, who had room on the right side. In fact, they actually pulled off this exact trick play that I'm talking about against the Titans in 2021. Frank Reich couldn't even pull off a trick play correctly. He too often overthought basic situations to the point where it looked like he didn't even trust his players to make basic clutch football plays. Another reason for Frank Reich's downfall was the general culture in the locker room. It does appear that there was a decent amount of camaraderie with the Colts players, but the entire tone of Reich's time as Colts coach never screamed out of a winning coaching staff. From what I, a brain-dead fan who thinks he can call a basic football play better than the professionals, have noticed, Reich only really got fired up whenever the team was winning. This 2022 season is a great example. After the Colts win against the Chiefs, Coach Reich was ecstatic in his post-game speech, praising the team and saying that they did everything right as a team. Then the next week, when the Colts lost to the Titans, the tone was more somber, which is understandable, but Reich just said the standard cliches about needing to improve and all that garbage. He did this after almost every loss as coach throughout his 4.5 years in Indy. The team hardly ever learned from losses from what it seemed like during Reich's time, and a lot of this has to do with Reich's coaching style. I hate to use this term because it really oversimplifies things, but Frank Reich was extremely soft, especially after losses. This led to a lack of accountability, especially with the quarterbacks. Wentz and Ryan didn't seem to be disciplined too much, leading to repeated mistakes in most games. Nowadays in the NFL, it is important to have an NFL head coach with clear passion for the game both inside and out. There was never a doubt that Reich was passionate about the game, but he never had the necessary excitement on the outside. When you are leading an NFL team, especially a franchise as prominent as the Colts, one of the winningest franchises in the last 2 decades, you are expected to show the necessary energy to form close bonds with your players, to support them, and to keep their spirits up when times get tough. I don't entirely blame Frank Reich for these issues, and he did seem decently liked by the locker room, but it never got to the point of other beloved head coaches like Andy Reid, Mike McDaniel, and Mike Vrabel, where the players fight hard for their coach. But once again, things really all went awry with the whole quarterback problem. Losing Andrew Luck was devastating, but Reich never fully understood the necessity of working to develop a young quarterback. Reich wanted to skip those steps and get straight to contention, but it never worked. Reich's quarterbacks after Luck were Jacoby Brissett, a career backup who performed solidly but not great, Philip Rivers, a formerly great quarterback well past his prime, Carson Wentz, a great player on paper but a guy who could never gain full confidence in himself, and Matt Ryan, another Rivers type, elite in his heyday but couldn't replicate it in older age. I truly believe that if Reich and the Colts had traded up in the 2020 draft to get Tua Tagovailoa or Justin Herbert, that the Colts would be the contenders we all thought they were in Reich's time. Instead, his unwillingness to swallow a year or two of QB development is what wound up costing him his job. I believe Frank Reich can be a good head coach in this league, but the constant change at QB tailspinned into an outright offensive ineptitude by the time he was ousted. As for the Colts, they traded Nyheim Hines just before Reich's final game against New England, but overall still have the solid core that they've had for years. Jim Irsay hired franchise legend Jeff Saturday to be the interim head coach, and Saturday appointed 30-year-old assistant Farks Frazier to call plays. These moves were met with skepticism, but the pair led the Colts to a win versus the Las Vegas Raiders in Week 10. Matt Ryan even regained his starting job and performed well, as well as great games by the offensive line and Jonathan Taylor. Unfortunately for the team, the shadow of Reich's tenure will loom over them for a while. Not an era that will be remembered for awfulness or incompetence, but an era that will forever be remembered for what could have been.